reading from Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall.
Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident.
One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple.
For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me high upon a rock.
Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At his sacred tent, I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord.
Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me.
My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek.
Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, God, my Savior.
Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me.
Teach me your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors.
Do not turn me over to the desires of my foes, for false witnesses rise up against me, spouting malicious accusations.
I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
It's for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord.
Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip in turn told Jesus. Jesus replied, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and will glorify it again. The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, this voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. The crowd spoke up. We have heard from the Lord that the Messiah will remain forever. So how can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? Then Jesus told them, you are going to have the light just a little while longer. Walk while you have the light, before darkness overtakes you. Whoever walks in the dark does not know where they are going. Believe in the light while you have the light, so that you may become children of light. When he had finished speaking, Jesus left and hid himself from them. Even after Jesus had performed so many signs in their presence, they still would not believe in him. This was to fulfill the word of Isaiah the prophet. Lord, who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For this reason, they could not believe, because, as Isaiah says elsewhere, he has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, so they can neither see with their eyes, nor understand with their hearts, nor turn, and I would heal them. Isaiah said this because he saw Jesus' glory and spoke about him. Yet at the same time, many, even among the leaders, believed in him. But because of the Pharisees, they would not openly acknowledge their faith for fear they would be put out of the synagogue. For they loved human praise more than praise from God. Then Jesus cried out, "Whoever believes in me does not believe in me only, but in the one who sent me. The one who looks at me is seeing the one who sent me. I have come into the world as a light, so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. If anyone hears my words but does not keep them, I do not judge that person, for I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. There is a judge for the one who rejects me and does not accept my words. The very words I have spoken will condemn them at the last day. For I did not speak on my own, but the Father who sent me commanded me to say all that I have spoken. I know that his command leads to eternal life. So whatever I say is just what the Father has told me to say.
We are getting back to our message series on the Gospel of John, even though last week technically we finished the Gospel of John, but we last were in the Gospel of John on chapter 12 on Palm Sunday, and then Easter Sunday we skipped ahead, finished off, and then we're going back. It is, and part of the reason why is because the Gospel of John in the next few chapters has a great deal of important words for us to grasp hold of. As the writer reminds us of what Jesus has said, is what Jesus has done, and how it applies to us. So as we continue in chapter 12, just after the triumphal entry, or as we commonly refer to it as Palm Sunday because of the waving of the palm branches, we come to the section where Jesus is teaching. And as we begin, as we look at it, I want to start off with two things. One is a little bit about myself. One of the things I deal with quite frequently is anxiety. One of the examples of this came when I was on a mission trip in Ecuador. I was there for about a month. And I don't know if you've ever tried to learn a new language and then being plopped into that space in the couple weeks of learning. Let me rephrase that. A couple weeks of starting to learn it. You have to speak in another language until it becomes almost second nature. You're thinking it in English. Then you have to think it in Spanish. And then you have to make your and because Ecuador speaks Spanish. Not that every language you have to translate from English to Spanish and then whatever else. But then you have to make your mouth say those words. And we sometimes forget how we take it for granted how our mouths are so used to speaking and saying certain sounds and talking in a certain way. And when I was down in Ecuador, there was my first time down, I was staying with a host family. I was with a larger group, but we were all split up into host families. And the host family that I spoke with spoke Spanish. After learning it for about 2 weeks, I was tired, I was exhausted, I was anxious. I shut myself into the room and I did not want to go out. My anxiety level was very high that day. And the reason why I mentioned this is because as we look at the different things that we talk about in the Gospels, sometimes we see Jesus healing particular physical or emotional or mental ailments. Sometimes it is very specific that it is a spiritual ailment that he is dealing with. And as we look at this, as we look at the Gospels, we have to remember that there is both happening. That it's not just one or the other. But there's both literally happening. So when I was down in Ecuador, and in this room, shut up, didn't want to go outside, and yet I felt as though God was speaking to me, just trust me. Go out and sit on the couch. I didn't want to speak another word of Spanish. I was exhausted. I was feeling very much overwhelmed. And yet that voice kept coming back, trust me. I could have very easily just laid there and allowed my anxiety to take hold, my fears to take hold. In this instance, in some instances I'm not as good, but this is a really nice instance, I went out and I sat down. And it wasn't as bad as I thought it was going to be. That the anxieties that were causing me great worry, it was actually a very peaceful time for me. And I tell my kids that there are some times when we are feeling overwhelmed and we keep going over things in our head and we allow what's going on in our head to dictate how we see the world around us. Sometimes we're not accurate. Sometimes we have to deal with and we have to trust. In this instance, it was trusting God. Trusting God to provide a way, trusting God to provide the strength to overcome those anxieties. So another instance is, for those of you who don't know, I'm part of the fire department. For those of you who don't know, I'm also afraid of heights. I've gotten better. And we had the opportunity to go up onto the aerial, and it wasn't straight up, it was pretty much on a 60 degree angle. The first time I got about two-thirds, three-quarters of the way up, and then it's like, no. Because it feels very strong and at the bottom, and then you get up and it gets a little bit wigglier, kind of bouncies. And the second time I went up, a friend of mine before me went up, and he's on the top of the aerial. He's jumping up and down. He's, by the way, he is harnessed in, but he's just showing it bouncing, and nothing happened. So I go up next, get to a point, pause, and my friends at the bottom are saying, just go another one, go another step. So I go up another, and they pause, and I go up another. I actually got to the top that time. And these are important. These are important because when we talk about the light of Christ, and Christ's light is shining here, sometimes it is God speaking directly to us. Sometimes it is God speaking through those around us. Don't let the fears and anxieties overtake you. And here's the other thing, is that sometimes we need help through those. Sometimes it is God who is the direct help. Sometimes God brings people around to support us, to encourage us. The third instance is, last little while I had a dream. And in that dream, there was, for lack of a better term, very much of a spiritual battle. And I remember praying in the dream, and I woke up continuing to pray because of what was going on. So it just highlights that there are those physical ailments when we get sick. And when we think about it, as Jesus healed the blind man, as Jesus healed the paralytic, as Jesus
also healed those who were dealing with a demon or the spiritual problems. And he's talking about the prince of this world in this section. And he's talking about Jesus' own light shining in the darkness that the prince of this world is casting into our world, into our daily lives. That light that Christ gives us, the light that Christ comes and shines into our darkness, whether it is our physical problems, our health problems, whether it is the mental anguish or grief or anxiety that we are dealing with, whether it is the emotional sadness that is overwhelming us, or whether it is the spiritual battles that too often we forget about, and yet Paul reminds us of. Some of the battles that we face and that we are dealing with in our lives, sometimes relationally, it's almost like there is a spiritual battle going on, a spirit of discontent that is affecting us. And I've seen that quite frequently. That it seems like the whole world is falling around, and every single problem that could possibly pop up is happening all that time. Sometimes it is those relational problems, and that's just a relational problem. And sometimes there is that spiritual aspect that is attacking us. And Paul reminds us in Ephesians chapter 6 that we don't war against each other. That the real battle isn't against each other. It is against the spiritual realm. It is against Satan and the devil. And yet sometimes we allow things that are rooted in the spiritual realm to take root in our hearts and our minds. Yet Christ is shining not just into the spiritual realm. He's not just shining into the physical realm. He's not just shining into our mental capacity. He's not just shining that light into the darkness of our emotional problems. It is that light that shines and impacts us on every single level of who we are. And we see throughout the Gospels, in this Gospel we start off with Greeks coming and want to see Jesus. They go to Philip. It doesn't say exactly why they go to Philip. Philip may have been closer. But then what does Philip do? He goes to Andrew. It almost seems like there's a hierarchy. Could have been a bit of a hierarchy, even though Jesus says that's not the way we do things. But it also could be that when we work together, when we share the burden and allow Christ's light to shine, when we share what Christ has given us to do, it's not as hard. So they both go to Jesus. And Jesus continues on teaching. What we don't see is Jesus saying, they're Greeks, can't come. We don't see that. They are able to partake in the experience and the teaching that Jesus is giving. And he also, and as Jesus keeps speaking, he himself says, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies. So he's starting to talk about his death. And in this instance, and sometimes it's very hard to go from the kernel of wheat or the seed, and we talk about the seed dying. If the seed stays a seed, it will never be more than that. But if the seed stops being a seed and allows the plant that is inside of it to grow, to take root, to be nourished, it can grow into whatever plant it was planted. In this case, it's talking about a kernel of wheat. And yet the seed has to die, that there has to be death. But Jesus goes on a little bit later, a couple verses down, says, now my soul is troubled. He is recognizing and he's sharing the fact that his soul is troubled. That in his humanity and being fully God, but also fully human, that there is that troubling, there is that dealing with the stress of what is coming. And he recognized, I could pray, Father, save me from this hour. But instead he says, no, it is for this hour that I, for the very reason I have came to this hour. He's trusting in God. And here's the interesting thing, that as we move forward and as we think about this, many times when we are in a place of trouble, when the storms are coming, when it feels like the darkness is coming at us, some people say, well, just have a little bit more faith. I've seen people who have lived with great faith, who have trusted God, who have experienced what one writer calls the dark night of the soul, where it feels as though that darkness is so immediate, so close, that there is no hope. People of great faith can experience this darkness. The problem sometimes is, how do we hear God's encouragement? How do we hear God's presence? How do we hear God's words? For as Jesus speaks these words of encouragement, it's not saying that you will never experience any trouble, but saying that it is that God is there with them, and then you hear God's voice speaking not just to Jesus, but so others could hear. And as we hear about at the end of the chapter, that what Jesus is saying is not just his own words, it's not just his own thoughts, but he is sharing with what God, our Heavenly Father, has told him to say. He's having that connection, even referencing Isaiah, is having that connection to God's words throughout time, and in this time also. How do we hear God's words of grace? How do we allow God's light to shine in our lives? Because when we're in that immediacy of our problems, whether it is physical, whether it is the sickness that is overwhelming us, whether it is the psychological dealings that are going on in our head and everything's whirling around. I don't know if you've ever experienced that. No, well, that's good. Whether it's that emotional weight, whether it's anger or fear, whether it's a great sadness. How do we hear? How do we change our focus from that darkness, from the reality that is going on around us? How do we change our focus from the lies that are being planted in our hearts and in our minds and focus on the light of Christ, who is shining for us to see? One of the ways is, how do we listen? How do we listen to God's voice? How do we listen to the voices that are around us that are speaking God's truth? How are we listening to God's voice through the Holy Scriptures? With that one, it's a little bit easier. It's spending time reading them. And when we start off reading them, sometimes we can get into the habit of, okay, I've read the Scriptures, check. So we've gone through them. We spend our time. It's kind of like we did our time. Had to do it. What did I get out of it? And yet, when we start off with prayer, say, Lord, here I am. Asking the simple question, or asking for God to just speak through his living word. Because you can read the same passage over and over again, and something new comes out almost every time. It's not that God's word has changed, but how we see and how we hear God has. What God has revealed to us in our lives, when we spend that time, when we grow in that maturity. When we're able to focus not on the darkness, but on God's light. When we're able to take our eyes off the problems and allow God's light and God's presence to be there, he reminds us that we are not alone in that. He reminds us of Psalm 27 says that he is a refuge, that he is a safe spot for us to go Do we take that time? Do we practice going there when the sun's shining, when everything's good, when all the bills are paid, when we can go and do all the other stuff that we want to do? Do we take time going to that place of refuge so that we know the way? I remember hearing, I've never had the joy of really spending a lot of time with a horse, and especially not a horse that knows its way home. Eventually, we'll have the joy of having a car that will know its way home, but that's a few years off. But when you practice going in a certain direction, when you take the time to practice going, when you take the time to practice looking to Christ, to look into the light of Christ, even when the sun is shining and everything else is going good, when we take that time to spend with Jesus, it's a lot easier to hear, because it's not forcibly making yourself turn your head from one to the other. It becomes natural. In karate, there are certain wise sayings, precepts. There's 8 precepts. My favorite is for those was, the mind is one with heaven and earth. Of those, it reminds us to be in tune with what's going on around us, not to ignore what's going on around us, not to just keep your eyes focused on heaven, but to see and to allow God to actually influence how we see the world around us. Because when we do that, the problems that can seem huge, that can seem so monumental, that can seem like we can't deal with them, we start to see them with God. Remember I mentioned earlier in the story about Ecuador, it wasn't that I had the strength to go and do it, but trust me. Trust God. We learn to trust God through it, that the problems that we face are limited, while His grace and His strength is unlimited. One of the other precepts was that technique will happen in the absence of conscious thought. If we don't practice in our faith, faith isn't just a, hey, I've got it. It's not just pressing a button. It is a muscle that we need to exercise, that we need to train. It is a gift from God, yes. But if we keep it stored in the closet and only bring it out when the problems come, how many times do we forget where the closet is? That safe spot. I don't know, has everybody got a safe spot where they know exactly where it is and they put all their important stuff there until you can't find the safe spot? I don't know if you've ever lost anything. I've lost stuff all the time. But when we practice, when we take that time to practice and to exercise our faith, when it's easy, when times start to get tougher, our heart, our mind, our body, and our soul will continue to know how to turn to God, to turn to God's light, to turn to the light of Christ living in us. Not just stored in a cupboard, but living in us. Not just up in heaven, but living in us so that we can see, that we can experience, and so that God can actually work in us and through us in those dark times. Because you see, we experience dark times ourselves, but so do other people. And we are called to also be a light to them as followers of Christ, that the light of Christ living in us will shine for all to see. Because here's the other thing. Sometimes we need those people speaking into our lives. Speaking words of hope, speaking words of encouragement. Sometimes we don't need their words, we just need to know that they're there and that we're not alone. Because one of the biggest problems that we face in our world today is loneliness. We can be hyper-connected and feel that no one cares. And yet, scriptures remind us that Jesus cares. Jesus said He did not come to condemn,
but to save. He did not come to cast out, but to welcome in. He came as a light, so that no one who believes in him should stay in darkness. He comes and addresses our darkness. Will we let Jesus into our dark times? Sometimes, miraculously, they will be solved. That's great. But sometimes, he is the one who is there with us. Though the storm and the wind may blow and the rain may pelt at our face, though we may be tired and afraid, we are not alone, for Christ is there with us. And he reminds us that the problems that we face, whether it is a health problem, whether it is physical, whether it is mental, whether it's emotional, or whether it is a spiritual problem that we are dealing with, Christ's light is there. We do not need to be focused on the darkness. We know that it's there, but he invites us to stay focused on his light, that we might experience his grace, his eternal love. For as we will find out in a few weeks, and as we will discuss in a few weeks, Christ says in chapter 14, I am the way, the truth, and the life. All those, or no one can come to the Father except for me. We remember that verse. The first verse of that chapter is, I am going to prepare a place for you in my Father's house. He's going to prepare a place for you. Not for your problems. For you. Not for something that will end, but for each of us who is dearly loved by God, made in God's image, so that we might find that peace, live in the security and in that refuge where the problems will be no more. For as Revelation tells us, chapter 21, there will be a time when there will be no more sickness, no more sadness, and that Jesus will wipe away all of our tears. Jesus reminds us to allow his words to speak the light that is needed to be heard, needed to be seen into the lives, to our own lives, into the lives of those around us. May we look and listen to the light of Christ that overcomes the darkness, that brings us hope, even in these times of problems, that reminds us we're not alone, that we are dearly loved and cared for. Amen. Announcements. Today there's a session meeting following the morning worship. Saturday, May 4th, leading with care workshop in Ingleside. Bible study continues at St. Andrew's at 10 a.m. on Monday mornings and at St. Paul's on Friday mornings. Wednesday, April 24th, St. Andrew's Chesterville is holding their monthly luncheon starting at 11:30 a.m. There is a sports camp that's coming up in Winchester. If you'd like some more information, I'm happy to share it with you. There is a poster at the back, I believe, and some little postcards. It's for ages 6 to 12. It's happening July 2nd to 5th, and it'll be happening at the Joel Steele Community Center. And those, unless there's other announcements. No? Okay. Good. Let's pray. Gracious God, we come to you and thank you that your light shines, whether everything is going right or whether we are weighted down by the problems that we face. Lord, we know that we can turn to you no matter where we are, no matter what's going on. And Lord, we know that your words can calm the storm, can ease the worry, can work through all the problems that we face.
Sometimes your words take away our problems, and sometimes you help us through them. Lord, no matter what, help us to trust you. Help us to be able to hear what you are saying. Lord, help us to have the time to listen, the time to see. Lord, help us. We pray that you would surround us with people to help, help to bear the load, to know the fullness of your grace and to share it, to live it out in this life and prepare us for the life to come. Lord, we know that there are many people dealing with many different problems. Lord, help us to be the lights that help to alleviate and not to add to. Help us to be lights in a dark world. Lord, we pray for peace in families, for peace in our hearts, for peace in our communities, for peace around the world. We pray for healing on the brokenness that too often trumps the good things that you are doing. Lord, help us to look to you, to look to your light, to hear your words, and to be filled with your grace. Lord, we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our mission moment. In the Kushkak village in Afghanistan, 42-year-old Guljan lived a simple life with her husband and four children until one day in October 2023, when an earthquake struck their village. Guljan lost her husband and 11-year-old son. After the disaster, she encountered significant challenges in getting assistance due to the gender disparities present in her village. However, PWSDs, or Presbyterian World Service and Development, partner recognized her needs and provided Guljan's family with a winterized tent to help endure the harsh weather conditions. PWSD provided food assistance as well as other support after the earthquake to help people survive the winter challenges. The light of Christ is given so that all may see and feel the warmth of God's love for all of us. Let us give out of God's blessing to us so that the light of Christ may be seen and shared. Let us give our tithes and our offerings.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Let us pray. Every good and perfect gift comes from you, the Lord of heaven and earth. We give you our tithes and offerings as you have given to us. May you bless them and use them to spread your light of hope around the world so that those in darkness may see the light of your love and experience the fullness of life that you have promised us through Jesus. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite us to turn to page, up on the screen. My mind's here and there. Hymn number 592, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky. That's okay. We'll get there.
Mm-hmm.
and Lord of sea and sky. I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will be my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord. If you lead me, I will go. I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My heart will say, finest bread I will provide. Their hearts are satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you I will hold your people in my heart.
Send us, Lord, into your world, sharing the light that brings hope to those experiencing darkness. May we bring your light into our homes and our communities so that others may know the truth of who you are and who we are because of you. Send us in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. It has been an honor to be able to gather together in the name of Jesus Christ to worship. May you go in peace, my friends. May you be at peace with God, with each other, and with yourselves. Amen.